Oh, hey, I'm glad you're here. I was just looking through some of the incredible photos of our solar system from NASA missions. Take this stunning composite of Jupiter and some of its moons, or this breathtaking shot of Saturn's icy rings. Oh, my personal favorite, this image of Pluto. It has a heart shape on its surface. Sure, it's a heart made of nitrogen ice, but it's still a heart. All of these photos came from different missions exploring the outer planets. It's pretty amazing when you think about it. Our solar system is so big that it can take years for one of these missions to reach its destination. For example, the New Horizons spacecraft took around 9.5 years to reach Pluto. When it launched, Pluto was still classified as a planet. Thinking about the long journeys of these spacecraft makes me wonder, how do we know where to send them? How can we predict where an object like Pluto will be nearly a decade from now? To find the answer, we have to go back over 400 years ago to a German astronomer named Johannes Kepler. Kepler figured out the rules of planetary motion. Today, we'll explore Kepler's three laws of planetary motion, which help us chart paths to the distant edges of our solar system even today. Johannes Kepler lived from 1571 to 1630, during a period that redefined our view of the cosmos. Early work in astronomy had relied heavily on philosophical ideas, but during the Scientific Revolution, people began using more systematic methods to answer scientific questions. In the early 1500s, Copernicus had proposed a heliocentric, or sun-centered, model of the solar system. This model challenged the idea that everything revolved around Earth. Astronomers who relied on evidence-based reasoning, like Galileo and Kepler, were key in advancing the idea of heliocentrism. In fact, Kepler was alive at the same time as Galileo. Much like scientists reviewing each other's work today, Galileo and Kepler exchanged letters, both encouraging and criticizing each other's work. While Galileo relied heavily on observations from his telescope, Kepler used mathematical models to understand the planets. Kepler's goal was to uncover the rules that governed planetary paths. He didn't focus on just describing how things looked in the night sky, but rather on using math to explain the observations. Kepler acquired an extensive dataset that included the exact positions of planets over years of observation. He analyzed this data to uncover patterns in the movements of the planets. Kepler's work gave rise to a new branch of science, astrophysics, which uses the rules of physics and chemistry to figure out the behavior of objects within space. Why does this matter? Kepler's approach transformed astronomy by showing that the universe follows predictable mathematical rules. This shift in thinking helped set the stage for modern space exploration. Based on his mathematical analysis, Kepler found patterns that led to three laws of planetary motion. A scientific law describes how nature behaves in specific situations. Let's examine each of Kepler's laws of planetary motion and see if we can figure out why they're considered so important in modern astronomy. One of the reasons heliocentrism was still debated in Kepler's time was that the model still didn't perfectly match the observed movements of the planets. However, while examining data about the orbit of Mars, Kepler discovered the issue. Planets do not orbit in perfect circles. For centuries, people had assumed that planets moved in perfect circles, but Kepler realized that planets actually orbit in an ellipse, a shape resembling a stretched-out circle. When Kepler used an ellipse for a planet's orbit, the mathematical predictions and observations finally matched. This revelation is the basis of Kepler's first law, known as the Law of Ellipses, which describes the shape of a planet's orbit. It states, "The orbit of each planet around the Sun is an ellipse, with the Sun at one of its focal points." A focal point is one of two fixed points that help define the shape of an ellipse. In a planet's orbit, the Sun occupies one focal point, while the second focal point is empty. Kepler's first law has an important implication. Look at this image. What do you notice about the distance between the Sun and the planet at different points in the orbit? Pause and record your thoughts. As planets orbit the Sun, their distance from the Sun changes. Sometimes a planet is closer to the Sun, and at other times it's farther away. This discovery laid the groundwork for the next of Kepler's laws. So, we know the first law is about the shape of an orbit, but what about the second law? It's all about the speed of a planet within its orbit. Kepler's second law of planetary motion, called the Law of Equal Areas, says, "A line segment joining a planet and the Sun sweeps out equal areas during equal intervals of time." Wow, that's a bit, complex. Let's break it down to figure out what it means. Let's start by imagining a planet in its elliptical orbit around the Sun. We can draw a line from the Sun to the planet. That's the line segment joining a planet and the Sun. As the planet moves within its orbit, the line covers, or sweeps, a certain area. Let's first observe the planet when it's far away from the Sun and note the distance it moves during 5 days. We could also calculate the area swept in that time. Then let's observe the planet's movement for 5 days when it is close to the Sun. If we calculate the area swept here, it will be the same as when Earth was farther away. If a planet moves for the same amount of time, the area swept will be the same. This is what Kepler meant by saying the line sweeps out equal areas during equal intervals of time. But what does that mean practically? Well, the time might be the same. The area swept might be the same. But besides the distance to the Sun, do you notice what's not the same? The distance the planet moved. During the time the planet was closer to the Sun, it traveled a much longer distance. What does that tell us about the speed of a planet when it's closer to the Sun compared to when it's further away? Pause the video and make a prediction. When a planet is closer to the Sun, it moves faster than when it's farther away. A planet's speed changes based on how close it is to the Sun. When Earth is closest to the Sun, it moves fastest. Alternatively, the Earth is slowest when it is farthest away from the Sun. This fact holds true for all orbiting objects. So, while Kepler's first law told us about the shape of a planet's orbit, Kepler's second law told us about the speed of a planet within its own orbit. I wonder what the third law tells us. For Kepler's third law, time is the key word. Kepler's third law, or the law of harmonies, gives us an equation to calculate the time it takes a planet to complete one full orbit. This time is based on a planet's average distance from the Sun. This law teaches us that the farther a planet is from the Sun, the longer it takes to complete its orbit. Earth, which is relatively close to the Sun, takes 1 year to complete this orbit. Based on Kepler's third law, would you predict that a distant planet, like Neptune, would take more or less time to complete its orbit? Neptune, which is much further away from the Sun, takes a full 165 years to complete one orbit. Understanding this relationship between distance from the Sun and the time it takes to complete an orbit allows us to predict the movement of planets and explore the structure of our solar system with greater precision. Kepler's first law told us the shape of a planet's orbit is an ellipse. His second law showed us that a planet's speed changes as it orbits. And his third law lets us know the time required to complete an orbit is based on the planet's distance from the sun. In your lesson activities and the next lesson, you'll be able to explore each of Kepler's laws in more detail. Taken together, Kepler's three laws of planetary motion are foundational for every space mission we launch and how we study space through the field of astrophysics. Kepler's work allows us to predict exactly where a planet will be years or even decades into the future. Today, we can send missions across billions of kilometers with confidence, knowing that the planets will be exactly where the math says they'll be. Thanks to Kepler's work, we can look up at the planets, not just with wonder, but with the tools to reach them. I'll see you next time as we continue our exploration of the cosmos. Hey, hey.